It's just a great feeling. You know, I haven't felt this in a long time. So.
Haven't been able to say this early in about 20 years. The Pats saved their season last night. It's been a while since we've been able to say that. In early November, Keyshawn, J. Will, and Zubin were presented by Progressive Insurance. Fellas, I'm not sure what was more strange. The Jets having the halftime lead. The Jets having a 10-point lead in the fourth quarter. Joe Flacco throwing three touchdown passes.
Just the same old Jets.
Or Nick Folk, the former Jet, doing his old team in with no time to go.
Much like the Dallas Cowboys or the Pittsburgh Steelers. Not worried at all. Just figured, they'll get it turned around. They'll be fine. And I've seen this movie a million times.
But
in Jet fashion, the Jets jetted it away.
But the ending may be a little bit different. You've seen this movie 1,000 times before. Pats rally to win, buck the odds, whatever small amount of doubters there have been over the years, they get stymied. The group is much larger now. But do you fellas still think they're a playoff team despite this win that took all of the 60 minutes to get?
I do. I absolutely do. They're going to be on the back end of that, though, right? They're going to be that 7th, 8th, 9th fighting to get to the 7th type situation. And in the end, they're still a playoff team to me. Here, look, go back a week ago. Cam Newton played fine, fumbles in the end. Instead of having the ball in his left arm, he's got it in his right. Instead of having it away from the traffic, he has it against the traffic. They punch it out. He fumbles, played fine enough to win the football game. Had him in a position to win the game. You fast forward to last night, you look at it, you go, it's the Jets. How could that be? Every now and then, 16 games is a long season. You're going to have a stinker, 2, 3, maybe even 4. Every single team in the National Football League, you can go around and look at close games and clunkers. I mentioned the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Dallas Cowboys. Pittsburgh Steelers are undefeated. That almost got taken away from them against the Dallas Cowboys. But it didn't. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers lost to the Chicago Bears. Do you really honestly think that the Chicago Bears, Jay Will, are better than the Tampa Bay Buccaneers? Not even close. So you're going to have those type of situations where they're going to be tough games. Now, they've dug themselves in a deep hole. They've got to continue to keep playing better to climb themselves out of it.
I really disagree. I don't think the Patriots are going to make the Super Bowl. Make the playoffs at all.
Oh, you got them going to the Super Bowl.
No, the conference. They're not going to make the playoffs. And look, I understand a win is a win, but how you win is important. Didn't we expect the Patriots to beat the Jets last night? The Jets are the worst team in football. Didn't we expect Cam Newton to come out and be somewhat decent to beat this Jets team? Now, if you want to talk about how they beat them, that's a different conversation than just the fact that they beat them. Look, they dominated time of possession last night. All right? Their defense, the Jets defense, was on the field for pretty much all the second half. In the second half, how about this, Zubin? The second half, offensively, the Jets only saw 4 plays. Offensively. 4 plays in the second half. I mean, that's in the fourth, I think. That's problematic. That's problematic. So you wear a defense down, and yes, you beat them by a field goal at the end, but how you beat a Jets team is pretty important, isn't
it? I'm encouraged watching, I almost said Tom Brady. I'm encouraged watching Cam Newton have a Brady-like performance. 27-35, 200 and some odd yards, finding a guy like Jacoby Myers, much like a Julian Edelman, someone to lean on that you have confidence in, that you're going to throw the football to. He rushed for 2 touchdowns. He didn't get one in the air. That's okay. That's okay. Brady wouldn't have the rushing touchdown. Brady would have him in air. But that's fine. At some point throughout the game, I believe Cam Newton was 11 of 11 or 10 of 11. And you know, methodically taking what they gave him, didn't force anything. I'm encouraged by that. Since coming back from COVID, he seems like he's getting a little bit better. And I go back to the New England Patriot Buffalo Bill game last week. It looked like Cam Newton had gotten better, even though they lost the football game. And then he picks up where he kind of left off from the Bills against the Jets last night. And again, I'll say it again. you're going to have some stinkers and some close games against teams that you may play down in their competition. It happens all the time in the National Football League.
On the other side, the worst team in football is off to its worst start ever. That's saying something. That's quite a double whammy there. The Jets are 0-9 for the first time. They didn't play with Sam Darnold's shoulder injury, didn't have Quinnen Williams' hamstring injury. The one bright spot the entire season has been their mammoth tackle, Mekhi Becton, who's been playing great football, left the game last night with a chest injury. Adam Gase was a little bit more sullen. Normally, he comes out really ornery in these post-game press conferences.
Well, the end is near. Can't say a whole lot.
Gotcha. He did say, we're doing everything we can. We're playing our ass off. It's just not enough. It was a little more positive, if there's anything positive to take from being 0-9. He usually comes in there a house of fire, and it gets really confrontational with the media. I didn't see that much of it last night when I was watching, but where do the Jets stand now? They're at a point they have never been in the history of the franchise.
I was on a 1-15 team. That coach got fired. That's all I can say. I was on a 1-15 team. The coach got fired. After 2 years. And so when you look at it, I would think that Joe Douglas and Mr. Johnson, Christopher Johnson, who took over for his brother Woody to run the organization, have some thinking to do. And it shouldn't be long. It shouldn't be long.
I thought he was part of the solution, though, not the problem, when referring to Adam Gase. So this is like what I said about sometimes when executives get up to a podium and they say certain things. Yeah, you take it for face value, but we all know what's coming with Adam Gase. Everybody feels it every time we watch a game, and you can't win these games, don't you, Key?
Well, yeah. When you 0-16 or 1-15, man, that's hard to sell. Yeah, okay, so if I go 1-15 and I'm in my first year as a first-time head coach and my team is decimated week in and week out and I'm losing players, or we're losing games by a field goal, or we're losing games by a touchdown, or whatever the case may be, and we're competitive, then I can carry that over because I can sell that to my fan base. But when I've already got a coach who's been fired from Miami, who's brought here, and my quarterback that we drafted the third pick at 3 years ago is regressing and not progressing, then I got to look at that and say to myself, I can't hold on to this. And that's okay.
I agree.
And that's okay for them to wait to the end of the year to make a decision on what they're going to do. That's fine. That's fine. I don't care if they fire him now or at the end of the season. I don't even want to call it fire. Parting ways with their coach at the end of the year right now. The Jets aren't going anywhere, so it doesn't really matter.
Well, that's why I go back to what we were talking about last week when Joe Douglas was talking about, hey, our quarterback, Sam Darnold, he's our future. You know, as it relates to Adam Gase, hey, look, he's part of the solution, not part of the problem. I hear everything you're saying, Joe Douglas. I understand this is you and a Mr. Johnson issue that you're going to work on collaboratively. But in the day, you're sitting up here telling me something right now. All this will change. It could change in time. And like I said before, Trevor Lawrence and company, if they find a way to win a national championship and people are talking about him being a generational quarterback and this team goes 0-16, we will be hearing different words from Joe Douglas's mouth in a couple of weeks.
It's very interesting that you bring up Trevor Lawrence again, because last night Mel Kiper Jr. on NFL Money NFL Countdown said that Trevor Lawrence and Justin Fields are locked neck and neck as far as 1A, 1B, however you want to look at it. And then you have the whole offseason to evaluate what that talent is in terms of the quarterback if the Jets decide, or whoever decides to go in that direction at the quarterback spot. Sam Darnold certainly is making it hard to evaluate him if he's not going to get on the field. The shoulder injury, obviously, a couple weeks ago, coming back and then trying to play on it, and then late this past week making a decision to not go because of the shoulder injury is hard, I'm sure, on Joe Douglas and whoever is helping Joe Douglas evaluate Sam to figure out whether he is the future or not. It can change. But based on what Joe said, I still got to believe that if they think that he may be the answer to them, along with a bunch of help around him. They had all three receivers on the field for the first time last night. Mm-hmm. But guess where Sam was at? He was over here with us. So Joe Flacco looked like Joe Flacco from the Baltimore Ravens with Sam toys. I don't know.
Yeah, Perryman looked all right. Their connection is certainly there and good. Again, you mentioned Mel Kiper Jr. He was on the show last week, reiterated to us it was 1A, 1B with Lawrence and Fields. Said the same thing last night on ESPN. And, of course, Mel's counterpart, Todd McShay, will join us this morning at 8:30, so we can kind of get
Todd.
Frank Caliendo getting it warmed up. for all of his impersonations. We'll see if Todd is in, and you love when I say this, Key. We'll see if Todd is in lockstep with Mel to see where he's got Lawrence versus Fields. We're asking you this morning on the Dr. Pepper Twitter feed. I don't think the answer is going to be the Pats or the Jets, but you never know. Who's the biggest threat to the Chiefs in the AFC? Simply put, who's the biggest threat to Mahomes and company? We want to hear from you. Be a part of the Keyshawn, J. Will, and Zubin Nation on the Dr. Pepper Twitter feed. ESPN Nation presented by Dr. Pepper. It's official. College football's back, and so is your favorite Dr. Pepper-loving college football town, Fansville. Head to a store near you to treat your inner college football fan.